And welcome to the Robert H. Jackson Center, Professor Kevin J. McMahon. Professor McMahon comes to us from the State University at Fredonia, where he's recently been elevated to Associate Professor in the Political Science Department, and I'm sure you'll all join me in congratulating Professor McMahon on that remarkable achievement. Professor McMahon earned his doctorate at Brandeis University and came to Fredonia via several other teaching stints. He's been to Russia, he has taught at Ithaca College, and he's also been a teaching fellow at Harvard University. He's a published scholar, and I guess what really brings him out today is the book that just came out a few months ago, Reconsidering Roosevelt on Race. Of course, Roosevelt is a titan in 20th century American politics. You could certainly say he's perhaps the major figure in 20th century politics, and there's certainly been no dearth of scholarship on Roosevelt. But Professor McMahon has really found, I think, a unique niche and has really mined some remarkable material to produce the book that he's going to tell us a little bit about today. I certainly, in my history classes, hold up President Roosevelt as, put him on a pedestal and hold him up as the model of all that is good and true and decent about politics. However, the one area where I have been known to excoriate Franklin is in the area of race relations. When I begin my unit on the civil rights movement, I'll ask my kids, well, when was the last time we looked at a law that Congress passed that helped African Americans? And we pretty much have to go back to the 1870s to find something like that. And I ask them, well, when was the last president we saw who did something to help African Americans? And we say, well, Franklin's cousin, Teddy, did invite Booker T. Washington to the White House in 1903. But other than that, have we really been talking much about American political institutions doing anything on behalf of African Americans? And I've dragged Franklin Roosevelt into that mix, citing as examples his failure to really include African Americans in the New Deal, specifically their exclusion from virtual exclusion from Social Security, the fact that the Southern states were allowed to administer their programs on a fairly local basis and thereby exclude African Americans from the benefit of those programs. I've talked about the fact that he refused to lend any support to the anti-lynching law that was trying to be passed through Congress. Of course, that was an issue in the South where Southern states absolutely refused to lift a finger to try to prosecute any of these examples of vigilante justice. And Roosevelt, perhaps rightly, perhaps wrongly, but feeling that his economic program was of the greater moment, refused to lend his name to it for fear that he would antagonize the Southern Democrats and be unable to push through the New Deal, which was, you know, his real baby. Well, in Professor McMahon's book, he's really challenged that. He said he acknowledges all these things, but he says there's an awful lot more that we're missing. And it's a very unique perspective, and I'm very much looking forward to hearing what Professor McMahon has to say today. I've been privileged actually to hear him speak once before. Last October, was it, Evelyn? He came and spoke to a group of teachers from Chautauqua County, under the auspices of the Teach American History Grant. And I have to tell you, in all candor, teachers are absolutely the worst audiences. We do all the things we tell our students not to do. We talk and chew gum and we don't pay attention. But I'll tell you, all those history teachers who were present that day were in very rapt attention, very much stimulated by Professor McMahon's presentation and stimulated a lot of thoughtful discussion thereafter, as I'm sure will happen here again today. So, please welcome me in joining to the Robert H. Jackson Center, Professor Kevin McMahon.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be invited to the Jackson Center. It's a beautiful facility, and the progress that's been made in 3 years is really, really amazing. So I'm very happy to be invited. What I'll be talking about today is really trying to link what I think are three important parts of the story that I tell to the book, in the book. Link them to Robert Jackson himself and the role he played in the New Deal administration and as a Supreme Court justice. Before I do that, let me begin by talking about the larger picture and what I was trying to do in the book, the story I was trying to tell. And I begin, if you look at Supreme Court decisions on race, on civil rights, after Reconstruction, you get a series of negative decisions. And the enabling of the white South to develop its system of segregation. So the Supreme Court, probably the best example of that is the Plessy decision. The court allows the South to build up these barriers, to build up the system of segregation. And then as you get into the 20th century, there's a reduction in the number of cases that the court hears. When it hears cases, they tend to be less significant. But then as you get into the 30s, you see a rise in, first of all, the number of cases that the court takes on civil rights, and in the number of cases which they decide in favor of a pro civil rights stance. So my question was, why this time? Why do we get these decisions? Most importantly, beginning in 1944, with the Smith v. Allwright decision on the white primary, and 10 years later, the Brown decision. And obviously, a lot of people have looked at this. We get various arguments of what the origins of these were. Some argue it's societal forces, right? That sooner or later, the United States was going to have to deal with the race problem. So you need to look at World War II and its importance. You need to look at the Cold War and its importance. And those are certainly powerful arguments. And none of these arguments do I really dismiss. What I'm trying to do is really add to the conversation. At the court itself, we have 9 individuals who ultimately decide unanimously to strike down segregation. You have to look at the leadership of Chief Justice Warren. Before Chief Justice Vinson died, the court was divided on the issue of segregation. The court first heard arguments on Brown in 1952. They decided to have re-arguments. And when Chief Justice Vinson died in 1953, the story goes that somebody met, one of his clerks, I guess, met Associate Justice Frankfurter in Union Station. He was coming back from Cambridge. Union Station, if you've ever been, it's one of my favorite buildings in Washington. But he meets Justice Frankfurter, and he gives him the news, and Frankfurter says, "This is the best evidence I've had that there is a God." Chief Justice Vinson is dead. And Warren obviously plays a role. He's the only Republican former governor of California. And certainly, it's important, I think, fundamental that the fundamental role that Warren plays is that you get a unanimous decision. And you may not have gotten that if the court decided before Warren's arrival. So, my argument is based more on the power of the presidency. I argue that what political scientists like to call is reconstructive presidents, presidents that have a great deal of political authority, that these are powerful agents of constitutional change. And FDR is considered one of these reconstructive presidents. Typically, when we think of presidents in the court, we talk about presidential weakness. We hear stories about presidents who are frustrated by people they appoint to the court. We hear President Truman calling Tom Clark that damn fool from Texas. When President Eisenhower left the White House, he was asked, "Have you ever made mistakes?" And he said, "2. They're both on the Supreme Court," meaning Chief Justice Warren and Associate Justice Brennan. But my argument is that at least in certain areas, and obviously with regard to FDR, that the story is different. That if you look at FDR's appointments, and perhaps more importantly, the activities of his Justice Department, his stamp is clear on the work of the Supreme Court beginning in 1944 and culminating in the Brown decision 10 years later. And this really is counter to conventional wisdom, as was pointed out already. The conventional wisdom is that certainly Eleanor did a lot in terms of civil rights. She was a symbolic force at the time, suggesting that there was something inherently problematic with a democratic society treating African Americans differently. But when it came to actual laws that were passed, nothing was done, and that's true. There were some 150 laws introduced by members of Congress during FDR's time in office, not one passed. Many argue it was because he didn't give his support, and certainly there's an argument to be made there. What I say, or the basis of my argument, is that conventional wisdom is skewed towards a legislative emphasis, that we tend to look too much on legislation. But if you look at FDR's appointments to the court and the work of the Justice Department, you get a judicial strategy that where FDR's hand is clear, that ultimately produces a set of precedent that leads to Brown. So let me go through this. Again, what I'm trying to do today is connect to some extent with Jackson. And let me begin by saying I think the beginning of the story to some extent is with the court packing plan. And some of you know that Justice Jackson, then not yet Justice, but Robert Jackson, was widely considered the most articulate defender of the court packing plan. And the court packing plan, as you may be familiar with, was an attempt by FDR to expand the size of the court from 9 members to 15. And this would obviously make the court much more friendlier to New Deal legislation that had been consistently struck down by the court, often by either 5-4 or 6-3 decisions. He does this right after his landslide victory in 1936. And the typical story of the court packing plan is that you have a president who's arrogant, who's just won this major victory. He thinks, you know, he's on top of the world, he thinks the people are with him and he can do no wrong. So he proposes a piece of legislation that disrespects the court as an institution, he bases it on age, so he disrespects some leaning members of the court, some of whom are friendly to the New Deal, like Justice Brandeis. And the Senate, most importantly the Senate, but the House as well, reject it. And it's often described as a president making a string of errors, which is prone to errors because he thinks he can do whatever he wants. He also has huge margins in both the Senate and the House, something like between 75% and 80% of both the Senate and the House are supportive of FDR. So you would imagine with those types of majorities, especially in today's age, when we have basically a split right down the middle, you would expect to do quite well. And he doesn't get it passed into law. He doesn't get to expand the court. And that, my argument here is that the typical argument is that FDR was trying to constitutionalize the New Deal. He was trying to change the court so that the court would declare key portions of what was called a Second New Deal constitutional. Most important for us would be the Wagner Act dealing with labor and the Social Security Act. Those are really the corner, those two pieces of legislation are the cornerstone of, or cornerstones of the Second New Deal. But my argument is that it's really a larger attempt to reconstruct the judiciary and transform it from a fortress of conservatism into a bastion of liberalism, an agent of the modern presidency, to work with the president, not to be opposed to the president. If you look at the opponents of that plan, the Korpakken plan, which again was defeated, you see conservative Republicans, so that's not surprising that they would oppose the plan. Another group is New Freedom, what we call New Freedom Progressives. These are typically supporters of FDR, but they're fearful of a strong central state. They would prefer that legislative action return, or action, governmental action, either return to the states or occur in the Congress. And they felt that the Korpakken plan was putting too much power in the hands of the president. And then the Southerners. Now, obviously Southerners are Democrats at this time. We have, the South is thoroughly Democratic. And the South is in part responsible for FDR's success in 1932 in becoming the Democratic candidate, and to some extent, his success in his first term. Even though they're a conservative force, they certainly take steps to exclude African Americans from key portions of legislation. The South, however, is concerned that if you add 6 Roosevelt justices to the court. And why are they concerned? They're concerned because if you think back to what I said at the beginning, you have of what happened after Reconstruction. The argument is that the court saves the South with decisions striking down civil rights laws of the Reconstruction period and in a sense endorsing state laws segregating blacks from whites. So you have individuals, as I said, like Carter Glass saying, we cannot have Roosevelt-type individuals on the court because we should be concerned about what it's going to do for the Southern way of life. And my argument is that there's a historical significance for the Korpakken plan. Even though it doesn't become a law, it's a bloody shirt of sorts. If you look at who loses, once Roosevelt does create his court, who loses before that court? Certainly Republicans do. New Freedom Progressives certainly do. And most importantly for my story is the South, the white South, despite the fact that the white South gives Roosevelt enthusiastic support at the ballot box. In 1936, Roosevelt won South Carolina with 97% of the vote. In Mississippi, 98% of the vote. So typically, political scientists think that if you support, this is often called realignment theory, if you support a president, and that president then puts individuals on the Supreme Court, that court should be friendly to the party that supported that president. But the result is not that. You get a court that's hostile to the white South. And Jackson is very important. Let me just read some of his words. His words are certainly significant during the Korpakken plan, but a speech he gives a year later is even more telling. Let's see here. He's talking to the National Lawyers Guild. And he first compares the group of lawyers before him to lawyers at the time of the American Revolution. And he says, "We too are founders. Founders of what tomorrow, what will tomorrow become the tradition of our profession in this day of change. We too are makers of a nation, the nation of tomorrow." We too are called upon to write, to defend, to make live new bills of right. So what it highlights is really this period of judicial transformation. Despite the rejection, the Senate's rejection of the court packing plan. So then the question becomes, well, FDR ultimately does appoint 9 individuals to the court, virtually remaking it. If you include Chief Stone's elevation from Associate Justice to Chief Justice. So who does he choose? What type of individuals does he choose? Does he choose individuals who are sympathetic to civil rights? Does he choose individuals with the idea that they'll actually take racially progressive positions once they're on the court? Now, there's not a lot of evidence for that. But nevertheless, he chooses people who are thoroughly liberal and who are certainly supportive of, sympathetic to the NAACP's argument. He also chooses some individuals who worked with the NAACP in various ways. Also, 8 of the 9 he appoints to the court receive the support of the NAACP's executive director, Walter White. The lone exception is Jimmy Burns, who was a senator from South Carolina. Also, to some extent, Hugo Black. But at the time of his appointment, that Walter White was a thoroughly supported Hugo Black's appointment to the court. And even after the controversy, when it's revealed that he was once a member of the KKK, White is a supporter of Black, that he believes Black is going to be a justice who's very supportive of the NAACP's position. And he's correct. Black becomes a leader in this area. Now, Burns' selection is interesting because in January 1941, Justice McReynolds retires, and he's clearly the most conservative member of the court, thoroughly racist, anti-Semitic. He refuses, for example, when Justice Brandeis, the first Jewish justice of the court, retires, he refuses to sign his letter of retirement. When Frankfurter, also Jewish, takes his position on the court, McReynolds refuses to attend his robing ceremony. McReynolds retires. And quickly, Burns is the front runner to replace McReynolds. This is FDR's 6th appointment. So he already has a majority. There are already 5 in place. That's January. FDR, however, delays. He delays for a number of reasons. At one point, and the leading contender against Burns is Robert Jackson. So the liberals are pushing Jackson, and Southern senators are pushing Burns for that one position. In April, it's heavily rumored that FDR will appoint Burns quickly. Walter White, again, the head of the NAACP, protest. At the same time, A. Philip Randolph is another African-American leader, has announced his intention for a march on Washington, something Roosevelt doesn't want to occur. And obviously, if you appoint Burns, who the NAACP rejects, it's going to provoke the March on Washington even more. FDR delays the decision, and for Burns, I write in the book, it must have been very frustrating, because Burns had already been passed over for a position on the court in 1939. He had been passed over for the vice presidency slot in 1940. So it must have seemed like, he was Charlie Brown to FDR's Lucy. But he waits, and what he waits for is the announcement, the long-rumored announcement that Chief Justice Hughes will also retire. When he does, FDR acts quickly, and he makes three appointments on the same day. He appoints Burns to the McReynolds position. He elevates Stone from Associate Justice, largely based on his defense of the New Deal. Elevates Stone to Chief and fills Stone's slot with Robert Jackson. So he pleases both sides. He pleases the senators, who he now has to bring back. He's been at odds with the Senate, but with the South, so with the Southern senators. He's got to bring him back in. Why? Because the war is building up. You have Lend-Lease legislation passed in 1940. Burns leads as Senator of South Carolina, he leads the fight in the Senate for Lend-Lease. The South is more supportive of his positioning on the war or on international policies than other senators from other sections of the country. So he gets to please the South with Burns, to please the liberals with Jackson, and Stone is a Republican. So he gets to send this message that it's a bipartisan choice. And with that diverse set of individuals, it's very difficult to counter their selection. Burns, by the way, is, if you think about today's confirmation process, which draw on and on and on, it takes the Senate about 8 or 9 minutes to confirm Burns' choice to the Supreme Court after they receive word. Okay. So as a group, there are two key principles that really define the Roosevelt justices. One is that, for the most part, they're sympathetic to the NAACP arguments that are being made, beginning really in 1938. And two, driven by a commitment to a legal philosophy called legal realism. And really, because of the conflict between FDR and the anti-New Deal court, they are committed to deferring to the democratically elected branches. They don't want to be an activist court, for the most part. They want to defer to the president, or they're willing. They have a philosophy of deferring, given the conflict that occurred in the mid-30s. So certainly that's an important part of the story. But I think it's one thing to appoint sympathetic individuals to the court. It's another thing then to turn around and use your Justice Department as a way to advance positions that, in a sense, ask the Supreme Court to take a stance on civil rights on civil rights issues. So at the same time, the NAACP is pursuing its cases, its civil cases in court. The Roosevelt Justice Department begins in criminal cases to attack four pillars of the White South. The white primary, again, the South is dominated by the Democratic Party, as suggested by those election results. Therefore, the only true election in the South is the primary. But since the primary in law at the time were the domain of the parties, which are private organizations, not state organizations, it was said in the law that you could exclude any person you wanted. Right? It was a party, it was a group, it was an organization. If you wanted to exclude people, you could. So throughout the South, Democratic parties, state parties, excluded African Americans. So you had the white primary. The poll tax was another target of their attack, of the Justice Department's attack. The poll tax is very, very straightforward. You had to pay a tax to vote. Oftentimes, in most states, you also the tax would accumulate. So if you didn't vote for a number of years, you would have to pay, you know, pay $10, or usually it was a dollar a vote in most states. But if you're poor, and this applies both to poor whites and poor blacks, you know, it's probably not worth voting. So they attacked the poll tax. FDR himself asked his attorney general to undertake a constitutional challenge on the poll tax. He calls it a remnant of the revolution, of the revolution era, that it was time for universal suffrage to occur. Another place they attack is lynching. So while FDR doesn't support anti-lynching legislation, his Justice Department works through prosecutions in the South to, in a sense, get everything that the anti-lynching legislation would have achieved, through a court strategy as opposed to a legislative strategy. And they also pursue a similar effort with regard to police brutality. And the laws that they use are old Reconstruction laws, much of which are considered dead letter laws. The prosecutions simply weren't brought under these laws. They tried to revive them. And if in the book, there's a chart, and if you look at the cases, these are cases between 1939 and 1945, that most of the victims in which the US government brings prosecution against an individual, the victims are African American. The laws become so identified with protecting African Americans that some people think they only protect African Americans. That whites, that if the victim is white, you couldn't use this federal legislation. So why is this significant? Because you have a time, you have sympathetic justices, and you have a Justice Department arguing that the court should act here. And again, Jackson is important. This is a longer quote, but what's going on here is there's a concern. How can the court be criticized for being active when it strikes down economic legislation as it did in the 1930s, but then turn around and strike down state laws on civil rights? Isn't it both activism and therefore problematic for a democratic system? And Jackson gives voice to the argument of why it can work. This is longer, but I think it's important. This is published when he's Attorney General, not when he's Justice. There's nothing covert or conflicting in the recent judgments of the court on social legislation and on legislative repressions of civil rights. The presumption of validity which attaches in general to legislative acts is frankly reversed in the case of interferences with free speech and free assembly, and for a perfectly cogent reason. Ordinarily, legislation whose basis in economic wisdom is uncertain can be redressed in the process of the ballot box and the pressures of opinion. But when the channels of opinion and of peaceful persuasion are corrupted or clogged, these political correctives can no longer be relied on, and the democratic system is threatened at its most vital point. In that event, the court, by intervening, restores the process of democratic government. It does not disrupt them. I am far from suggesting that our civil liberties can be adequately assured by the courts, but to the extent that the courts can serve to vindicate civil liberties, the recent decisions of the Supreme Court show how the job can be done. It is of more than passing interest to observe that a court which is governed by a sense of self-restraint does not thereby become paralyzed. It simply conserves its strength to strike more telling blows in the cause of working democracy. With that thinking, that the court can still be active if it's protecting democracy, right? If it's protecting free speech, freedom of assembly, and in the case of race, the right to vote in what is the real election, like the primary. What's the result? The result is that you get, I argue, you get a Roosevelt court that's constructed in a fashion to be instructed on race. In other words, it's there to listen to the Roosevelt Justice Department. Willingness to defer to the executive branch, and then you have the Justice Department coming in and asking the court to act in these areas. Again, as I said earlier, this campaign, this undertaking by the court begins in 1944 in Smith v. Albright, the decision striking down the white primary. And it culminates 10 years later in Brown versus Board of Education. Significantly, both the Truman and then Eisenhower administrations continue along this activism, that their Justice Departments continue advancing a progressive position on civil rights in arguments before the court, friend of the court briefs. And these cases, earlier cases, and then ultimately in Brown, challenged the doctrine of separate but equal. And then finally, in 1954, May 17th, the anniversary is, 50th anniversary is coming up in May. Just 9 years after FDR's death, and with five Roosevelt justices joining a unanimous opinion, the court strikes down the separate but equal doctrine in Brown. So that's the connection, obviously, between Roosevelt and the Brown decision. Thank you. South Carolina, and he runs for governor, he becomes governor. And he actually attempts to convince the court to argue to save segregation. When you look at the newspapers the day of or the day after the Brown decision, for example, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution says it's surprised that members of the South, the Hugo Black, who's from Alabama, Stanley Reed, you mentioned, why would they side with the NAACP's position? It's unclear in Reed's case why he ultimately comes around, but I do think that Warren's importance to the story is significant in that regard, that he really wants a unanimous opinion. The story is that he works with Reed, or tries to convince Reed to join, and in the end, Reed doesn't want to be alone in dissent. I would argue that Reed, given the nature of that court, it would have been very difficult for Reed to be a sole dissenter. That in a sense, the institutional mission of the court at the time was one that was quite progressive on civil rights. And all these decisions in the 40s and 50s are unanimous decisions, with few exceptions. When there are dissents, they tend to be one or two members of the court. And Reed is consistently in the majority of those opinions. So while it's hard to take that final step, ultimately, I think it's not surprising.
Yes. Did the Democrats dominate politics in the South prior to Hoover?
Say it again.
Did the Democrats dominate politics in the South prior to Hoover?
Yes.
All the way up from very early.
From Lincoln. Lincoln is the Republican Party, okay. The African American support. You know, part of the story that I didn't get into is, you know, the motivation for FDR's actions. One motivation is the African American vote. The African American community that can vote in the North, while it's quite small, is thoroughly committed to the Republican Party, the Party of Lincoln. In 1932, African Americans support Hoover. With about 75% of the African-American vote goes for Hoover. In 1936, it flips. 75% go for Roosevelt. And the concern that Roosevelt has is that while the African-American vote is small, if it makes makes up, say, 5% in New York, in key industrial, electoral-rich states, a switch back to the Republican Party can be devastating for a Democratic candidate like FDR in 1940. So, you know, part of this is driven by an attempt to please the African-American community at a time when FDR is not doing much in terms of the legislative arena. Yes?
That kind of leads into what I was wondering about. What do we know about FDR's own personal feelings about race?
Right.
Is he conscious of, first of all, is he conscious really of what he's doing here? If so, right. Is it for political reasons or is it for personal reasons?
Yeah. That's a very good question. And, you know, FDR, in part because, you know, he doesn't leave office on his own free will. He obviously dies in office. We don't have some of the resources that we have, you know, with other presidents who write their memoirs. And I guess now you get paid a lot of money to do that, so it's even more enticing to do that. But if you look at a lot of the documentation in the Roosevelt Library, the Library of Congress, you know, FDR is famous for writing these very short notes. So it's somewhat frustrating. I think the best way to get a sense on what he was doing, I would argue that the main reason why he was doing this was for political reasons. He thought the South produced more conservative Congresses than they should have, right? That he thought he had a lot of supporters in the South, right? And that if you could unite poor blacks with poor whites, you could get a very progressive politics. But because of things like the poll tax, oftentimes, the number of voters in the Democratic primary was very small and tended to be people who were more conservative. So he thought, you know, if you could expand the pool of voters, you wouldn't have to worry about people like Carter Glass or people like Cotton Ed Smith, who famously walked out of the Democratic convention in 1936 when he saw a black minister praying for the Democratic Party, that expanding the pool would give you a more progressive politics, more progressive Congresses, leading to more progressive legislation. And I would argue that's the main reason that he does that. At the same time, he does have a larger view, if not of civil rights, of human rights, that is certainly sympathetic to the progressive position. He says, for example, on anti-lynching legislation, which you brought up, when the anti-lynching legislation is being debated, Eleanor is sitting, you know, in the viewing area of the Senate. And he says, if I didn't support the legislation, I can't come out and say I support it because of what it will do to my coalition on economic issues. So you don't get a lot in terms of his personal stances. And, you know, for example, he tells jokes, some racist jokes sometimes. Is that significant? Perhaps. But I think if you look at decisions, you know, like his appointments to the court, continuing to frustrate Burns, for example. When Burns leaves after 1 year, he has an opportunity to appoint Leonard Hand, who's widely regarded as the greatest judge who never became a Supreme Court justice. And Frankfurt is pushing Hand hard, or pushing for Hand hard. And he ultimately appoints Wiley Rutledge. And the argument there is that he does so in part because of Hand is going to be more consistent with Frankfurt, who's more of a restrainist. Rutledge is going to join William Douglas and Hugo Black, the real progressives on the court. Another argument is that if FDR's justices had lived longer, the two most liberal justices that FDR appointed Rutledge and Frederick Murphy, both died in 1954. They're replaced by Truman justices who were widely considered to be cronies, you know, poker buddies that Truman liked to hang around with, widely regarded as not very successful members of the court. I think you would have had Brown earlier than 1954.
Mm-hmm. Eleanor Roosevelt, she died, what, 1962? Do you know of anything that she ever wrote or made any personal comments about the past, about his presidency? Well, as you mentioned, he died, of course.
Right.
Did she ever comment years later, since she lived so much longer?
Right, about issues specifically with regard to his thinking. It's a good question, not that I'm aware of. And she's certainly the liberal, you know, she's frustrated by FDR. She's, you know, Walter White, the head of the NAACP, is good friends with Eleanor. And she's often instrumental in getting White in to talk to the president when he's trying to be blocked by some of his more conservative advisors. So he does frustrate her. You know, she's certainly an advocate for racial advances, right? And certainly more supportive than FDR would have been. But she's more of, she's defined by principle. He's pragmatic. I write that he shows fits of courage. When he can do something on race, he does it. When it's helpful to him, he does it. When it isn't, he doesn't do it. So she's consistently pushing him. Sometimes he'll do things, sometimes he won't. Did she ever write anything? Not that I'm aware of. But it is a good question.
Kevin, in your book, you have a quote from William Lichtenberg, which he's the foremost authority on FDR, and it says, "I have rarely read a more challenging book at a time when legal scholars are cocksure that constitutional change is brought about by judges. Kevin McMahon boldly insists upon the decisive role of presidents. At a time when historians are unanimous in deploring Franklin Roosevelt's submission to the cruel reign of Jim Crow, McMahon sees FDR as an engineer of racial liberalism. Reconsidering Roosevelt on race will command attention and stir controversy from the moment it is published." Have you had the controversy?
Well, the book just came out a month or so ago. But the controversy, you know, eventually would be that, you know, the standard conventional wisdom is correct. That you can point to a lot of FDR's writings that suggest my argument. So we'll see. Not yet, but we'll see. Yes?
When you look at the people that he had to pick from when he made these decisions,
right,
were there people who were a progressive in terms of his economic programs who would not have been a progressive on race?
At the time, I think you might include individuals like Stanley Reed, you know, Southerners who were more conservative in their outlook. It's interesting, despite the fact of what this court ultimately does, he picks people from the Deep South. Most presidents hadn't done that before, in part because Republicans dominated the White House. But he picks, you know, Hugo Black, who's widely regarded at the time of his appointment to be the most radical man in the Senate. He's a senator from Alabama. Picks Black. Picks Jimmy Burns, a senator from the Deep South. And according to Burns' biographer writes that, and this is his interpretation, not mine, but he writes that it was FDR's thinking that by taking Burns out of the racially hostile politics of South Carolina and putting him on the court, he would emerge as a true New Deal liberal. That may be. Burns is only on the court for 1 year. During that 1 year, there aren't many significant cases. He does suggest, to some extent, that he's going in that direction. Certainly a more conservative voice. He's no Hugo Black. But there is some suggestion. Now, what ultimately happens is, as I said earlier, he goes back and, and leads the fight to save Plessy. But on the court, he does, you know, I think environment is important here. Obviously, if you're running for the governorship of South Carolina, you have to say one thing. If you're sitting in the shiny white building on near Capitol Hill, you can do something else. So, you know, I think FDR was selecting individuals that were certainly consistent with his liberal ideology. And while FDR is not necessarily clear on his commitment to civil rights, he's certainly clear on a world view that's supportive of free rights, of civil rights, of human rights. You see this in the Four Freedoms speech that he gives during the war. That's an example.
I'd like to thank Kevin McMahon for coming and joining us today and setting off a series of events. There'll be a reception downstairs, and we want to thank the Chautauqua Region Community Foundation and Johnson McCoyan. We have President Dennis Hefner, your boss,
yes,
came here today. And we also have an attorney from Russia who joined us all the way for this event, Kevin, specifically to be here. So thank you for coming and joining us. Appreciate it. Enjoy, and we hope to see you at other events. Thank you very much. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you.